Right, Aki Kareem for British Boxers. We're over here in Leeds today for the press conference for Warrington Takush. I'm here with the main man himself, Sean O'Hagan. Good to see you.
And it's lovely to see you here in the beautiful city of Leeds.
Exactly, it is a beautiful city.
Beautiful.
It's raining a lot though.
Well, it's alright a minute, lad, but it's a long day, isn't it? You know, could all change.
Could all change. Talking of, you know, long days, it's always a long day for you doing the media stuff and... But that's just, I suppose, part of being a world champion camp, isn't it?
It is, yeah, that's it. It's come to be expected now. We have a lot of long days, which we get well rewarded. So you've got to bear with it, haven't you?
You've got to bear with it. I've just done a little interview there with Jimmy Harrington, and one of the questions I put to him is that, you know, as a team, you're getting a little bit of stick for the choice of opponent. Considering the last three you've had have been top-class boys, do you think that's a bit unfair?
I don't really, because he's ranked 10 and Barrigala, didn't he? I would have expected a bit of stick if we'd have picked the number 15 Italian, or number 13, number 14, but we didn't. We went straight to number 4, because number 2 and number 3 is vacant. Mm. So in effect, he's number 2, isn't he?
So it's really the best you could have got?
Is there a minute? He's on a 6-year winning streak. He's never been stopped. He's very, very experienced. Two of his losses were dubious. In a 35 fight career with 13 knockouts and only 1 points loss. I don't see anybody really can justify giving anybody stick for that, you know.
He's a very experienced campaigner as well, hasn't he? He's seen all different looks and types and styles.
He can fight, make no mistake, that guy can fight. And again, like I say, he's the highest ranked opponent. He jumped at the chance to fight us, where three other world champions turned it down flatly. So
anybody, tells you about his intent, doesn't it?
Tells you about the intent. But listen, you're always going to get knockers in this game, aren't you? Yeah. You're always going to get people with something to say. Usually people that have not ever done anything themselves and know very little about boxing.
Yeah.
And certainly know absolutely nothing about how negotiating and trying to secure fights actually works.
Yeah. You still train like the challengers for these big world title fights. You still train as the challengers. How do you actually maintain that mentality and how do you motivate everyone around you, in a sense, to train like the challengers for these big fights?
It's a kind of natural thing to do because, like I say, we know the opponents, we know the kid, we know the records, and we know the, you know, the actual ins and outs, and the truth behind it is a very, very dangerous opponent. If we want to walk away still as a world champion, then we've got to train like we train, and that's like the challenger. Nobody will give you anything in this, you know. You'll get that belt. While we're snapping at other people's heels, two or three people, we might have 30 or 40 snapping at our heels, you know. So we've got to maintain that momentum, haven't we?
Is he a bit of a marked man then? You know, when he was on the way up, you know, the negotiations were different, but now people want a lot of money to fight him, people want to put the stipulations in to fight him and stuff. Is that what you're finding at the minute then?
Yeah, we're finding that on a daily basis, really. I mean, we've got Michael Conlon and Shakur Stevenson, padded out records. Some poor Lithuanian or Polish bakery worker that's, you know, been very, very limited. Journeymen, padding the records out with journeymen. Then all of a sudden, they want to fight world number one for a big chunk of money. It's wrong, really, isn't it? You know, let them fight each other, let Shakur fight Conlon. Let Shakur fight Barry Gallard. You know, let Conlon fight Gallard. They're good fights at their own level. And that's what they should be doing, instead of trying to just jump on Gravy Train, you know.
Yeah. BT now, after fights, released these clips of, you know, the trainer speaking to the fighters in between the rounds and everything. I've seen a few of you speaking to Josh. Your manner with Josh is very unorthodox, in a sense. It's very relaxed, and you know, giving very sort of concise information. You know, is that just because you've cultivated that relationship over the years? You've always been with him in the gym. Is that how you have that relationship with him?
Yeah, I mean, we get a bit of stick for that as well. People say, what's he talking, what's he saying that for? They don't know the relationship we've got and the language we use in a camp. You know, I might ask him for one thing, and that might lead to me getting what I want, but to view in public at home, it might just seem like a foreign language. You know, they don't know how we converse, they don't know how we get our messages across, and then we drag out of the fighter what we want, you know. So it might not make a lot of sense to them, but to us it
clearly
does. I think so. We're in 30 fights now, aren't we?
Are you going to be satisfied with anything other than a stoppage win, or you're not bothered how you get the win? Is it just a case of getting the W and then looking ahead?
It's about the win, isn't it, really? I mean, I think Man United at the moment would settle for a 1-0 win every week, wouldn't they? Or a couple of draws even, you know? So it's one of those where, as long as we get that win, I don't care how we do it. But what I would say is, we need to really, really make a statement. So
is that to try and lure some big unification fights in the future, you know, making that statement, putting out there?
Yeah, I mean, unification fights at the moment are not, they're not coming thick and fast, for all the efforts that Frank and his team have put in, and he has put them in. You know, they're not exactly queuing up at the other three world champions. So it might be that we have to kind of move up a weight division. If we can secure them at Super Feather, then we'll do that.
Just one final one. I saw a video on the way here of you, Josh, doing the ticket run. You know, going and delivering the tickets and being a people's person. Yeah. Was that always something you intended to do? Then go out there and be like the people's camp. I asked the same.
Yeah, we've always done that. We've done that right from the start.
Yeah.
Can I just take off 1 minute?
Yeah.
Alan.
On that final note. What's that? All right. Is that your ringtone?
Hello?
I want to record. You want to record it, right?
Hello? Yeah, listen, I don't want to buy up today, pal, yeah? All right, I've no money. Okay, thank you.
I'm glad I got that on camera.
There we go.
Yeah, the people's team, dropping the tickets off, going having a, you know, having a pint in the pub with the supporters and fans. That's something that, as you go up the levels, that starts to wane off, but it hasn't with Josh.
No, we still do all that. We still go out delivering tickets and socialising with fans and that sort of thing, you know. Yeah. So we've always been fan friendly.
Yeah.
They put us where we are, don't they?
I suppose that's why the people of Leeds always come
that's
out.
Why. Yeah. That's why. That's why. We like to make a fuss of them, and it's not just to promote ticket sales, but we don't know actually, you know, we know thousands of them personally by name, you know, being with us from the start. Yeah. So.
Last one, how do you see the fight going? I know it's a bit of a boring question prediction-wise, but how do you see the fight panning out?
Stopping it first half.
Right.
That's what we want to do.
Sean, thanks so much for your time. Really appreciate it, and look forward to seeing you Saturday night. Cheers.
Been a pleasure.